of consumers, and that's what we are today. And they also lynched us. These lynchings were not over no white woman. These lynchings were for political and economic reasons to run the people off the land. If you wouldn't sell out, then they would come and kill you and your family members. Okay? But after slavery, we began to invent. These are inventions. I've tried to put all this on one graph so you can see the relationships. So these are the inventions. I'm going to read off these inventions to you in a minute. But then all this persecution dropped that level. Okay? 1900, there was 10 million acres of land. This is agricultural lands, acres. By 1910, there was 16 million acres. They didn't know about this before 1900 because there was no census. The first census in America was done in 1900. They found out that we were 10 million strong, and I mean 8 million strong, and had 10 million acres of land. By 1910, we were 10 million strong and on 16 million acres of land. They said, oh Lord, these Negroes about to take over. So somebody said, you all will have to control them. So they lynched us, they burned us, they killed us, they terrorized us, ran us off the land. But in 1930, something happened. Well, what happened was they didn't change, the law didn't change, but a man showed up. The man who showed up was Master Farad Muhammad, and he came with a wheel. Okay? He came with a weapon that could destroy America in 12 hours. Mr. Farrakhan, in 1985, had an experience on that wheel that we're going to talk about later. But the enemy knows about that wheel, and so he had to back up a minute, okay, and get a new strategy. Now he had to trick us because he couldn't just kill us the way he wanted to, had been doing, lynching us and burning us. Now he had to be a little bit more careful about what he was doing, technology. So, what did he do? He set up the NAACP, he made jobs in the North, and the KKK down South. Same Jews made the KKK down South as the ones who made the NAACP up North and made jobs for us up North. Listen very carefully, the same Jews. We're going to talk about them in a minute. Now here, they run us from the land into the cities. And that wasn't enough. See, 1910 to 1960s, that wasn't enough. In 1962, they come up with what's called an adaptive approach. The Committee for Economic Development came up with what's called an adaptive approach, where it said net migration out of agriculture has been going on for 40 years and at a rapid rate. Nevertheless, the movement of people from agriculture has not been fast enough. This adaptive approach recommended that vocational agriculture courses in the rural areas be scrapped, farm children be given college scholarships to study anything but agriculture, and agricultural prices be substantially lowered, and temporary income programs be instituted to protect the most suited for survival. Now, who do you think the suited for survival? Those are the white farmers. So they lowered the prices so the black farmers couldn't make no money, lowered the price to the white farmers, but they took your tax money and paid the white farmers underneath the table so they could keep going. But this is how they are so wicked. They said vocational agriculture courses were scrapped. Mm-hmm. So that means, and then they said that the children be given college scholarships to study anything but agriculture. So you destroyed the high school agriculture programs, vocational agriculture in high schools, and then you give them scholarships to study anything but agriculture, so they would not be able to come back home. To get the job now, they had to follow the money trail, which would not lead them back to the rural areas. It would take them out. Same thing with the Babylonians taking us out, taking us to another land. They did this through a technology, through the educational system, and it was not just in agriculture, but they did this to all vocational education. It's in the 60s. Historically, junior high schools and high schools have offered vocational courses such as home economics, wood and metal shop, typing, business courses, drafting, auto repair. And schools have put more emphasis on academics for all students because of the standards-based educational reform. So in other words, the standards-based educational reform wiped out home economics, wood, metal shop, typing, business courses. So now black people students would come out of high school with no education. Then they would send them to college, and they would learn skills to work for the white man and his corporations, leaving their communities behind. So let me show you what we left behind, even under segregation, what we had going on, and why they had to come up this technology of under segregation. They had to change that and make integration, because under segregation, for instance, from 1863 to 1913, 50 years, I'm going to read you some of the inventions that we had come up with. And if we were allowed to turn those inventions into production instead of them taking the inventions from us and they produce it and sell it back to us and to the world, we could be a rich people right now. But here's some of the inventions that we, black people in America, came up with coming right up out of slavery. Air conditioning unit. Frederick M. Jones, July 12, 1949. An almanac by Benjamin Banneker. Automatic gear shift, baby buggy, bicycle frame, cellular phone, chamber commode, clothes dryer, doorknob, egg beater, electric lamp bulb, elevator, fire extinguisher, fountain pen, gas mask, golf tee, guitar, hairbrush, horseshoe, ironing board, lawnmower, lawn sprinkler, lock, mailbox, mop, peanut butter, pencil sharpener, phone transmitter, refrigerator, spark plug, stethoscope, stove, street sweeper, thermostat control, traffic light, tricycle, typewriter. Now these are things that we take for granted every day, and we think the white man invented them. We got the proof, patent office, black men and women invented these things, but could not benefit from it. I know about a story in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Black man had a soda. He made it orange soda. He was doing real good until the white folks found out that he was black, and then they boycotted it. And that's what they've been doing to us for the last 460 years, boycotting our humanity, boycotting anything we had to do. Saying what we got to do ain't worth nothing, even though we did it all for them, but we try to do it all for us, then it ain't worth nothing. For instance, we couldn't go drink at a water fountain the white folks drink at, but white folks had their babies being suckled from the black woman's breast, the nanny, but they can suck from her breast, but we weren't worthy to be able to drink from a water fountain? These are hypocrite lying devils. Sorry, I hate them. Now, on the segregation, not only do we have, by 1910, 16 million acres of land, we had 60 plus all black towns, okay? And in Tulsa, Oklahoma, we had 600 black businesses, and they were destroyed by the American military in 1920. And the people who they ran out from Tulsa could not come back to Tulsa unless they had a piece of paper with the name of a white person that they're going to work for, because you could no longer be free and independent in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And this has been it's an engram amongst black people right now that they say, if we go, you Muslim talking about going, where y'all going to? You know, you have some land over there, then white folks ain't gonna do but come and bomb you. Well, that's because, you know, we didn't have a God back in 1921 that could defend us. But he came in 1930. So we say, we in the Nation of Islam, we are not afraid to go out and to build for our own, build for ourselves, to build a new world in America. Because we believe that there's something protecting us. And I bear witness, I ain't scared of these crackers, because I believe that the baby planes, anytime I need them, if Allah decides, they'll show up. And if they don't show up, I'll fight like hell and take a couple of crackers out with me. All praise due to Allah. Also, under segregation, look, places like North Baton Rouge, Louisiana, has 16 black-owned grocery stores, 6 restaurants, 3 ice cream stands, 5 service stations, 6 auto repair parts stores, 2 motels. This is North Baton Rouge, Louisiana. 4 dry cleaners, 4 cab companies, 1 bus company. I was born in a black hospital in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. We had a black bus company there also. 2 drug stores, 2 upholstery shops. This is just in North Baton Rouge, Louisiana. 4 medical doctors, dentists, 2 realtors, 2 funeral homes, a movie theater, insurance company, shoe repair shop, photo shop, bank, printing press, and lumber yard. This is in North Baton Rouge, Louisiana. We thank the sister for doing that research for us, because these things will be lost, because, you know, we weren't keeping up. We were just living. We didn't know that we was going to be taken down and our cities would be destroyed. Let me show you how they went about destroying our towns, our cities, our economic zones. See, these people are scientists at doing what they do. But now scientists are here with me and you, and we're going to do some things now, ourselves. Now, look at this game. Okay, this set of blocks in the black community, business zone in the black community. You have the different thoroughfares, major thoroughfares, minor, going zigzag. And then on each one of those, the corner, you know, in business, what? Location is everything. So here's the corner, corner, corner. Well, you can have one or two or three or four businesses on each on a corner. So that's like I said, one business here. You can have a business here, business here, business here, business here, business on the corners, right? Okay, what they did was they ran these bypasses. Four lanes, six lanes, eight lane bypasses right through the downtown areas in the black community, in the segregated portion of the black community. So now they cut off this street. They cut it off with that highway. Now, when the white communities, they will put an overpass or an underpass that they own as the main arteries. They let one main artery open. But they cut this off here and cut this road off here. So now, what people do is go up to this main artery, get on the expressway, shoot up to the mall. These other spots are no longer viable. And these spots are still viable, but then they come along with rezoning. And now you can't have certain businesses in the spots that you used to be able to have those businesses. And the white folks come in, they get it, and then they rezone it again for them, and then they take over. So now they got their business in our communities. But these bypasses were done in mostly all the black communities, where they destroyed the thoroughfares in the black community and destroyed the corners for business. So they removed the entrepreneurship, those who can make some money on their own, and they sent us all to go to school. Okay? We forgot about building, and I call them faggots, walk around with a briefcase, you know, switching, doing what white folks want them to do, very intelligent, but only for them, for the white man, not for themselves. But it could have been different, okay? But the enemy, not only did he go through and cut through our communities, he knew that there was going to be a time for the coming of the Messiah. And this is the FBI secret files on Black America, 1960 to 1972. Division 5 also worked to prevent the rise of a Messiah. Some people say Black Messiah, but it didn't say that in the FBI files. It said Messiah, because white folks already know on Messiah to go be, it'd be a black one. Someone who could unify and electrify the militant black nationalist movement. Malcolm X has been the most likely candidate, but his assassination removed that threat. Malcolm was simply the martyr of the movement today. Muhammad was hardly a more viable threat because of his age. In the final analysis, Division 5 said Carmichael and King were the only serious candidates. And of course, they ran Sokolow Carmichael out of the country, and eventually they killed King in 68. And they thought they killed Honorable Elijah Muhammad in 75, but they missed. He's on the plane, and they're very upset, very scared. They assassinated Malcolm X, but not before Malcolm X did a lot of damage. You see, here are three of those Messiah types. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, which you say is really is the Messiah, but he was considered one by them, possibly, and he believed in separation. Martin Luther King had that type of charisma, but he was pushing integration until he met the Honorable Elijah Muhammad after 1966. Then he began to change a little bit from integration more towards economic independence. And then Malcolm X. Malcolm X was first with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Then he left the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and moved to more towards integration. So Malcolm X died, leaving us in a state of confusion. In ancient Egypt, a Set was the god of confusion, the red one, whereas the black one, Osiris, but his brother Set, the red one, is the god of confusion. This is the way we should have gone all along. But now we are confused and we are suffering from that confusion. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is still alive, so we still have a chance to survive. Now, to show you the power of us being educated and working for them, this movie came out 2 years ago, or last year, Hidden Figures. And these were the computer girls. And these computer girls were the ones behind the NASA program of going out of space. These were the computer girls. They were the computer. As a matter of fact, they were so good, even when they came up with the IBM computer, according to this movie, that John Glenn would not go by the figures from the computer until she checked those figures. This sister right here. Until she checked those figures, he wouldn't go fly. So there would never have been a John Glenn going in outer space if it was not for this sister right here and these sisters right here. So behind the scenes has always been them capturing us, putting us to work for them, and then claiming their work for them, claiming the work of us for them. So we need to put our sisters and brothers together to work for ourselves instead of working for them. Then we can build a heaven on earth the way we built the heaven for them. So even now, you know, okay, you move now. Also, you like you got a little kente cloth here. Now you got a briefcase. Oh, that's slick looking. But you ain't got nothing up in his head. The idiot. Don't know how to build nothing. Don't know how to think for himself. Don't have the black book. You see, at the corporations, there's a black book. And that black book is the suppliers and the customer base. So if you don't have a customer base and you ain't no supplies, you can't manufacture nothing. Okay? So they didn't teach us that part in them corporations. So we walking around with a briefcase, even though it may be kente cloth, but we don't really know anything about business. We just know how to do what they told us to do. You know, we like a really sophisticated robot. And then on top of that, they destroyed our values. So like now, women are called bitches and whores. They're having children out of wedlock. Then the government gave them money so they can have children out of wedlock and feed them. But the man could not be around. So they systematically destroyed our community, even our families, to now that black men and women, young black men and women, don't even think about getting married. There's no stability at all. So they can pick us off one by one as they're doing. But we fell for the okey-doke. Bling, 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 bling. Okay? So the ones who didn't go to college, they get into drugs or rapping, or they get into hooking. Okay? Even some of them who are in college, the sisters that pay their way through college, go and get what? Rained on with dollar bills so they can pay their way through college. Okay? Remember what they did to us all the way back with Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. They killed our men, they raped our women. That's what they've been doing and they are doing today. We need to stop it. And the black woman, she's out of the kitchen, she's out of control. 82% of black women are overweight, and one half of all black women are clinically obese. Okay? Fat, dying from diabetes, from cancer, from heart disease, from strokes. We are able to now eat in the white man's kitchen, and the white man is poisonous in that kitchen. We need to get out that kitchen, get back in our kitchen. But you know, a lot of black women don't want to do that because they want to be free. Well, look at you. It's a shame. So, under integration, we are dumber, we are sicker, we are poorer, and we are in jail. Now let's look at what we're talking about being poor. Here's from 1984 to 2007. Here's high income whites. Look at how the income is going up. Here, medium income whites. Theirs going up, not as much as the high income whites, but going up. But look at the high income African Americans going down, and the middle income African Americans flatline. So are we ever be able to catch up with white folks in going in this direction? We need to change directions. Integration has made us lose our self and our position in relationship to the very people who we trying to be like. Come on, y'all. Let's turn that around. And it is being turned around. The reverse underground railroad is in effect. What I mean by that is that, remember I showed you the graph, the picture of us being leaving the South, going to the North, to the cities? Well, when they're retiring, they're coming back home, okay? Now we need to organize that. We need to organize and plan return of our skilled elders to train our youth. Bring them back down where we have some land left, okay? Let's set up some communities. In those communities, it's gonna be farming, processing, manufacturing, and we're gonna come up with some ideas from a master Farah Muhammad is gonna bless us with some ideas that we're gonna be able to produce products that the world wants. And we gonna be back on top again. Right now, America's for sale. Who's buying America right now? The Chinese, the Japanese, the French. They're buying up America. The white man is leaving America. Trump is scaring the white man out of America because Trump is so crazy that white folk know that a war is about to happen. And they don't want to be a part of no war where they can get hurt. They like to send people and fight for them. So they're afraid the bombs will be over here. Okay? So they're leaving it so we can buy it. Then do something for ourselves. So let us clean up the black woman and the black man, and let us suit up that head, okay, with some mathematics, some understandings, some science, and pray that when the wheel comes, that it will find us on our post the way it found the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan on his post, September 17, 1985. You know, I heard some people say that there was a 70 years respite given to the white man. His world was opened over in 1914. So 70 plus 1914 is 1984. So people say, well, what happened? Well, my opinion is when Master Farah Muhammad showed up on the wheel, this man right here was on post. So instead of destroying America, he gave him wisdom. He gave him knowledge. He gave him a program that got us through the process of the planned destruction by the white man. As a matter of fact, when I put Obama in office, Mr. Farrakhan was supposed to say something negative about Obama when Obama, under Hillary Clinton's advice, killed Gaddafi, but Mr. Farrakhan didn't fall for that okey-doke. And so they were stuck with the black man in office for 8 years, and the white folks so upset that they put in Trump, and now Trump is scaring the hell out of his own kind. The whole thing is falling apart. So now white folks is leaving America in droves. Those who got money are getting up out of here. They're selling everything. So we take that money and let's buy some of this land for ourselves and our young people. Let's build something. Now this Savior's Day, we had a program at Savior's Day. We started going through what's called a charrette, led by one of our brothers, Brother Horatio, the engineer, civil engineer, of how we're going to build a community. We're going to continue that process at Founders Day, July 6th, 7th, and 8th, here in Muhammad Farms. Go on MuhammadFarms.com, and you'll see, go into the post, and you'll see Founders Day. Hit that, and that'd be the registration and the schedule. One part of that Founders Day, along with picking stuff and carrying stuff back with you, we're going to have a process of think tank, us thinking about what are we going to do, how are we going to build a new community. And we want our elders in particular to come, and our young people, because we got to hook up our elders and our young people together, start thinking about how we're going to rebuild the South, how we're going to rebuild the wasted communities, the wasted towns, the wasted cities that we ran from from 1910 up to 1960. We ran, and these places are run down. We can buy them very cheap, but what we're going to do with them is the question. We got to come up with some ideas. One of the ideas, of course, is taking the food, the raw product, and processing that raw product into a value-added product that we can sell to the consumer and that we can put people to work. We got to come up with a bunch of ideas. It's time now to build. We've taught the teachings, and if the teachings are available now to anybody on the internet. Mr. Farrakhan had the 52-week turn into 58-week series of the time what must be done, and he laid it all out. Anything you want to know, he's laid it all out. So now we got to start thinking about how are we going to make the right decisions, how are we going to plan, how are we going to develop. Don't worry about America being destroyed. Mr. Farrakhan said, we build now. Allah does not necessarily have to burn America up for 390 years, according to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and Mr. Farrakhan, but that is a choice. Master Farah Muhammad is not underneath the 24 scientists who wrote history in advance. They can only see past to 15,000 years. They couldn't see into the 16,000 years. They can see to what Master Farah Muhammad was going to do. Master Farah Muhammad can remove the white man without destroying the land and give the land to us. Assalamu alaikum, family.